Good morning. Welcome to Collegedale Community Church. We are so glad you're here worshiping with us today. Got a few announcements today. Today we have Children's Church, so after Children's Story, if you want to take your kids up to the Connection Corner, it's on the second floor on that end, but please remember to pick them up when you leave. We also have potluck today, so hopefully you've prepared for that. And then next Sabbath, we're going to have some areas out in the lobby where you can donate clothing for homeless people. I believe our women's ministries group is leading this out, and so they're doing a big push for some clothing. So if you have some extra clothes you'd like to donate, please bring those next Sabbath, and you can drop them off in the lobby next week. Also, there is a table for our Vacation Bible School. If I remember correctly, I think there were over 100 volunteers last year. It takes a lot of people to put on VBS. So I encourage you, if you are available and willing, please sign up at the table out there. Great ministry, very important. In front of you in the pew, you'll see Connect cards. You can fill those out if you're interested in having Bible studies, or you want to be baptized, you want to transfer your church membership. But just so you know, we only transfer in, we don't do transfers out. If you have a prayer request, you can put that on there. And we pray over those every week at staff meetings, so we take those very seriously. And then you can drop that off in the baskets in the very back, and that's where you can put your tithe and offering. We don't pass the buckets since COVID, but we do have baskets in the back. So as you leave, thank you again for your support of our ministry here. Let's get our worship service started with a word of prayer. So I invite those who are able and willing to kneel. Father in heaven, Lord, we're so grateful for your love, for your care, for all that you do for us, Lord. We are beyond amazed at how good you are. And Lord, we need to hear a word from you today. We need to feel your presence in our life. And so I invite your Holy Spirit and your holy angels to saturate this building, and that we may be like sponges, and that we may soak it up and be full of you. And Lord, I want to pray for all the prayer requests that are out there. Lord, we have a lot of things on our minds and our hearts. And Lord, we want to give those to you now so that we don't have to worry about them, that we can just focus on you and focus on worshiping you. Pray for Pastor Jerry in a special way, that the words he speak would come directly from your throne, and that those words would change us for eternity. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Opportunity to celebrate baby dedication. I want to invite the Pinner family to come up at this time. They actually might be working on something right now. We'll call them up in just a few moments. It's hard with multiple kids. So we'll have the Pinners come up in just a moment, and instead we'll turn to a different part of our program.
Good morning, children. Come on forward and let's have a story just for you. Come on down. After the story, they'll collect an offering for our Education Assistance Fund, and then they will be taken by their parents if they want to be involved with Children's Church. Well, good morning, boys and girls. I have a Bible verse for you today, and then I'll follow it up with a story. The Bible verse is found in Proverbs 17, verse 25. It says, "A foolish son is a grief to his father, and bitterness to her who bore him." This is what it means. A person, a child that acts in disobedience is a grief to the father, and a child that acts in disobedience is bitterness to their mother. Do any of you know what bitter is? How would you describe bitter? How? Something that doesn't taste good? Coffee is bitter? Mm-hmm. You would say that? Yes. Acorns? Yeah. I've tried them too. Yeah. Bitter. It just doesn't taste good, doesn't set well in the stomach. And our poor mothers, when we don't behave, their hearts are bitter. It means they're so disappointed. Oh, children, we want to obey our mom and dad so that we don't cause disappointment and bitterness. It reminds me of a story. When I grew up, there were five children in our family. We had a dog at this time named Sniffy. Sniffy was a wonderful dog, a brilliant dog. Sniffy is one of the dogs that I know will be in heaven. We've had a few dogs that don't stand a chance, but Sniffy will be there. And Mom and Dad, here's what I learned, I heard. I was a light sleeper. And when all five of us children were in bed and supposed to be asleep, sometimes I'd still be awake. And I could hear Mom and Dad in the living room talking softly, and I could hear the cellophane bags being ripped open. That meant treats, either potato chips, cookies, or something. They all came in cellophane bags. So I knew there were treats somewhere in the house. They were hiding them, but I knew they were there. And I determined I was going to find a treat. It was 2 o'clock in the morning. I woke up. It was quiet. It was dark. But I knew there were treats somewhere. And I decided I was going to find one. So I started to walk down the hall. Had to be careful. Our house was very old, and the floor would creak. So I'm walking quietly past my parents' bedroom, turned to the living room, and then went into the kitchen. Now, Sniffy was there. And when you're going to be a sneak, you have to be good. So I knew I had to make it look like I had a purpose for being up. So I decided I would let Sniffy outside. Now, Sniffy just kind of looked at me like, "Really? 2 in the morning? You're making me go outside?" But Sniffy was a good dog, so she went outside. And I did that so if I got caught, I could say I had to get up to let Sniffy out. It would kind of cover my tracks a bit. So Sniffy's outside, all the family's asleep. I climb up on top of the countertop because I know up high there's goodies there. I opened the cabinet, reached in there, and I found the absolute biggest chocolate bar I had ever seen in my life. It was about this long, about this wide, and it was a full inch thick, and it had great big squares. Oh, man, I hit the mother load of treats. This was going to be outstanding. It was going to be exciting. So I broke off one of those squares. And when you're sneaking, you got to be fast. You can't leave any crumbs, can't leave a trail. You got to eat fast. You got to destroy the evidence. You got to enjoy it quickly. So I put it in my mouth, and I started to chew. And yeah, this stuff is awful. And I read what it said. Unsweetened baker's chocolate. It was bitter. It was awful. I couldn't do anything. It was already in my mouth. It was half chewed. I was committed. And there was no place to put it without getting caught. And so I had to finish chewing. I had to finish swallowing. And by the time it was over, I knew what bitter meant. It was bitter in my mouth, bitter in my stomach. It was the worst treat I had ever had. But I know this. As a child, if you don't obey your mommy and your daddy, you can make your mommy's heart bitter. Isn't that awful? That's awful. None of us want to do that to our mothers. All right, children, grab a bucket and take up the collection, and then you can go to your children's church.
All right, at this time, I want to invite the Pinner family to come on up. A special time. It's a beautiful family. Come on up, guys. We've got parents, Jared and Lauren. Come on over here. Big brothers are here. But today, if you guys haven't met him yet, we've got Everett with us here. Everett Finn, isn't this a handsome guy? This is pretty cool. You guys are all looking great today, matching colors and everything, which I know takes a lot of effort. So great job, guys. This is a joy to come here and be able to dedicate Everett to the Lord. You guys have done this before. You're not new at this with two other boys. You guys have already gone through a baptism of fire with raising kids. And so this is just more of the same posture that you guys want to be in, giving God your kids, trusting God with your kids. And whenever I think of dedications, I always think of the Bible verse, 1 Peter 5:7, which says, cast all your cares upon him, and you guys know the other part, because he cares for you. And oftentimes when we think of that, we think of cares as being burdens or difficult things, but it's more than that. It's the things that you care about. And I know for you guys, it's been fun getting to know you. You care about your kids. And so, of course, not only do we want to put our problems before God, but we want to put our most precious blessings before God, too. And that's what dedication is. It's coming together and saying, God, this is what we care about the most. So, of course, we cast it to you because, God, we know that you care for us, that you care for Everett. And that's what we're going to do today. Before we do that, we have something for you. We have a certificate here, which I'm gonna hand this one to you. Can you hold that one for us? Our big brothers here. And then we have a quilting ministry. You guys are probably aware of this at this point. A group of people who their passion is to let you guys know that you're loved and you're cared about. in Everett to let you know that you're cared about. They've made this quilt for you to commemorate this event. And the heart that they have, the hope that they have, is that at some point, as you guys already know, as you're raising these young men, there can be challenges, and there can be times when you might feel like it's isolating. They want you to know that whether Everett is wrapped in this or perhaps you are, that there's a church community that loves you guys and wants to support you. And that's what this has been made for. So we'll open it up here and take a look. Thankfully, he's better at holding things than I am at folding things. So this is all going to work out. This is all going to work out. Well, we want to have a prayer of dedication, and I think he'll let me hold him. So just want to have a prayer of dedication. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we rejoice at this precious life. We thank you so much for this whole family, Lord. And we thank you that this family, mom and dad and big brothers, want to help raise Everett to love and to serve you. Father, we ask that your spirit would come upon him. We want to dedicate him to you, to your love, and to your care. And we just ask that you would bless this sweet family. In your name, Jesus, amen. At this time, we want to invite you to stand, and we're going to sing a special blessing for this family. Give him a round of applause. Thank you.
Entire choir up here together, and it takes us a minute to get us all up here. We've grown. And I'm going to go ahead and put out the invitation now because Jerry did it first service. If you would like to join the choir, we just invite you to show up. We rehearse Thursday evenings from 7 to 8 up in the Connection Corner, which is the room right across from the church office. And we would love to have you join our ministry. We are a family that loves to sing and worship together. So we hope you enjoy praising the Lord with us today in song.
Bye.
would like to invite you to stand to sing our last song with us. You may be seated. We have prepared a very special music for you.
They've been practicing. Didn't they sound wonderful? Really did. Really did. We have a program that will be here at our church, and we've got some folks that are going to tell you about it. These young people are members of our Adventurer Club, and Lauren is the leader of our Adventurers Club. Children, stand right here. I moved the pulpit so people could see your pretty faces. All right, so tell me about the program your club is hosting next weekend on April 28th.
All right, so we're hosting. We're hosting a dinner program and a silent auction to raise money for people in need.
What type of needs are you raising money for?
Well, all of our adventurers picked out projects that they're raising money for. So, Rowan, what are yours?
Chickens and bees.
Chicks and bees. Chickens and bees.
What about you, Jace?
The house project and clean water.
So you're raising money for clean water and warm houses. And what about Ella?
Dental care.
Dental care. For people who need
it. Dental care. Wow. Well, what type of food will you be serving?
Italian and cheesecake.
Italian and cheesecake? Oh.
We're trying to get you there with the cheesecake.
I'm in. Any other thing?
Anything else? Caesar salad. And some garlic bread.
Yes, and I have ravioli written down here too. Sounds like a wonderful meal. And you will also have a program and silent auction?
Yeah, so each of the kids are doing different things in the program. Some of them are singing together. But Rowan, what are you doing?
I'm doing violin.
Violin.
What about you, Jace?
I'm assigning a Bible verse.
A Bible verse?
Handbells.
Handbells. All right. Wow. So, why are you doing all this?
For Jesus.
For Jesus, yes.
Right.
And that's wonderful. Is there anything else that the folks need to know?
So we need you guys to pre-register. Why do we need them to pre-register, Jace? Oh, he's getting pretty shy. We don't want to run out of cheesecake.
That's right. All right. Well, let's give these folks a round of applause. I did need to ask you, how do they pre-register?
Yes, it is on...
Online?
It's on the hub.
On the hub.
There's a form on the hub, and you can register or you can donate there, and it gives a little more information. It will be at the church, though, on Sunday in the fellowship hall.
If you don't know how to use the hub, just call the church. Rosa will help you. From Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. till 12, she's there to help. Before we open God's Word, I want to welcome you and welcome the folks that will be watching online. This is our very first week with our brand new cameras, and they've promised me that they will make me look younger, taller, and I will come across more intelligent. Amazing what technology can do. So if you are watching and you happen to notice that that's true, please give us, let us know. I certainly want to hear about it. Let's have prayer. Father in heaven, this journey we're on, we can't do any of it without you. We can't even understand your word without you. And so we're praying, please, Lord, teach us. Show us your way. Show us the path. Show us your mercy. Give us hope. Convict us of sin in our lives. Do whatever is necessary. Do what is needed. And we pray that all of us will hear from you. All of us will walk out of here closer to you than when we came. We pray for miracles. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our passage of study today is found in Luke chapter 16. Luke chapter 16, I'll be reading from the New King James Version, and that's what will appear on the screen. Verse 1. And he also said to his disciples, there was a certain rich man who had a steward, and an accusation was brought to him that this man was wasting his goods. So he called him and said to him, what is this I hear about you? Give an account of your stewardship, for you can no longer be steward. Then the steward said within himself, what shall I do? For my master is taking the stewardship away from me. I cannot dig. I am ashamed to beg. I have resolved what to do, that when I am put out of the stewardship, they may receive me into their houses. So he called every one of his master's debtors to him and said to the first, how much do you owe my master? And he said, 100 measures of oil. So he said to him, take your bill and sit down quickly and write 50. Then he said to another, how much do you owe? So he said, 100 measures of wheat. And he said to him, take your bill and write 80. So the master commended the unjust steward because he had dealt shrewdly. For the sons of this world are more shrewd in their generation than the sons of light. And I say to you, make friends for yourselves by unrighteous mammon, that when you fail, they may receive you into everlasting habitations. He who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much, and he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in much. Therefore, if you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in what is another man's, who will give you what is your own? No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Now, this passage is one of the passages that pastors skip when it comes time to preaching. The parable is an awful parable to figure out. There's not one decent character in it. And fortunately, when we understand what a parable is for, it's for the purpose of sharing a point, making a point. It's not an allegory where every character or every thing commented on is a picture of something or someone. Jesus will use bad to illustrate good. The parable is making a point. Then Jesus follows up with three applications. Let's look at the point. The point is the sons of the world, the lost, are more interested and determined to secure their future than the sons of the light, who are the saved. So by contrast, by comparison, Jesus is trying to make a point. He then makes three applications. Use your money to make friends for eternity. Be faithful to God with your money, and you cannot serve God and money. The context, Jesus is in Perea, which is east of the Jordan River. He's in the last rounds of his public ministry. In 3, maybe 4 months, he will be crucified. And he is teaching large crowds, and at this time in his life, he is repeating some of the things that he has said earlier in the Gospels. So some things will not necessarily be new, but they will be applied in a way that could be refreshing or new to someone who is just hearing them. In this chapter, we will discover it is about wealth and about eternity. If you look at verse 1, it says, "He also said to his disciples, there was a certain rich man." If you look at verse 14, "Now the Pharisees who were lovers of money." If you come to verse 19, "And there was a certain rich man." So Jesus is focusing on wealth and eternity. We begin. Look at verse 1. We'll study it now. "And he also said to his disciples, there was a certain rich man who had a steward, and an accusation was brought to him that this man was wasting his goods." The word "wasting" that is used there is the same word that was used in the parable of the lost son. The son lived with prodigal living, which means wasteful. It's the same Greek word. So we had the parable of the prodigal son. Now we have the parable of the prodigal steward. A steward back then was someone who was not part of the family. They were not a slave in the household of the family. They were a hired person to oversee the family's riches, the investments, the businesses of the family. And this guy was found out to be dishonest. So he is going to be called in on the carpet, if you will. Verse 2, "So he called him and said to him, what is this I hear about you? Give an account of your stewardship, for you can no longer be steward. Turn in the books, you're fired." That's basically what's happening there. So the steward is going to do some contemplating about this. Verse 3, "Then the steward said within himself, what shall I do? For my master is taking the stewardship away from me. I cannot dig, and I am ashamed to beg." In other words, I am going to be thrown into poverty. I will have no source of income whatsoever. So he's considering how to secure a future. In verse 4, he comes up with an idea. He says, "I have resolved what to do, that when I am put out of the stewardship, they may receive me into their houses." He is going to come up with a plan that he will make friends of people who have done business with his master, and they will either let him stay with them from time to time, or he may find employment in their businesses. So he's going to plan for his future by creating friends. Verse 5. "So he called every one of his master's debtors to him and said to the first, how much do you owe my master? Verse 6. And he said, 100 measures of oil. So he said, take your bill and sit down quickly and write 50. Why quickly? Well, he's got to turn these books in soon. He's running out of time. Do it quickly. Verse 7. Then he said to another, how much do you owe? He said, 100 measures of wheat. And he said to him, take your bill and write 80. So that's his plan. These guys that this is happening to, that's a tremendous, tremendous amount of money they will save. And they're so grateful, and they're eager to sign that they only owe that much. So we come to verse 8. "So the master commended the unjust steward because he had dealt shrewdly." Now that's just odd. I mean, it's like the Bible is commending dishonesty. Well, we continue reading. "He dealt shrewdly." Then Jesus makes this point. "For the sons of this world are more shrewd in their generation than the sons of light." Shrewdly means clever, wily, artful. And we could ask the question, why is the master not angry? Well, maybe he was, but that's not the point Jesus is trying to make. On some level, the master thought, wow, that's pretty clever. And it could be that the amount that was deducted on what was owed was the interest that the steward was skimming off the top for himself, so the master would have had no loss anyways. We don't know. It doesn't matter. It's not the point. The point is, Jesus is saying, the sons of the world are more earnest, focused, and determined to secure a future, even if it is only in this life, than the sons of light are in earnest, focused, and determined to secure a future for eternity. So Jesus is saying, the worldly work on it. They strive to secure a future, even if it is only here. And Jesus says they're more earnest to do that than believers are in their commitment to eternity. That's the point. We come to verse 9. Jesus says, and I say to you, make friends for yourselves by unrighteous mammon. What? By friends? By unrighteous mammon, that when you fail, they may receive you into everlasting habitations. Now let's back up. Go to verse 4. I have resolved what to do, that when I am put out of the stewardship, they may receive me into their houses. Jesus is building on that theme. Receive me into their houses. Jesus says, receive you into everlasting houses. So there's an application here, and the application is this. Look, use your money to make friends. But what kind of friends? It means the friends that you will help get into the kingdom of God. And when they would receive you into their everlasting habitations, it simply means this. You will have used your resources for the kingdom of God in such a way that people will be in heaven because of your resources used by God. And when you get there, they will say, hey man, come into my house. Let's visit. Because of you, I am here. Jesus goes on in verse 10. He who is faithful in what is least is faithful also in much. And he who is unjust in what is least is unjust also in much. Therefore, if you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, that just means worldly goods, who will commit to your trust the true riches, talking about eternal riches? And if you have not been faithful in what is another man's, who will give you what is your own? Jesus is saying here, look, true riches is heavenly wealth. Everything else already belongs to God. But when you get to heaven, if you've been faithful, you will have stuff given to you that will be only yours and yours alone throughout eternity. I have no idea what that will be, but that's what he's saying. He makes another application. No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. That means money. You cannot serve God and money. The illustration that he's using would have been very familiar to the people back then. That's when slavery was very much a part of the Roman Empire. And when someone was captured from a foreign country and brought to Rome and they're on the auction block, you know, if they're a person of great physicality and somebody needed a slave to do manual labor, the bidding would begin, and you could have two people bidding against each other. Now, never ever did it happen that the auctioneer would just say, you know what, you know, we're going to run out of time here. You both want this fella, so we're going to have a co-ownership here. You can have him, and you can have him, and you'll just have to figure out when you can use him. And that situation The person will learn to love one and hate the other. Spend all day working for this guy and just lay down in the bed ready to go, and this guy shows up, say, no, no, you got to come work now. You can't serve two masters, Jesus is saying. And he's saying when it comes to money, money either masters you or you master it. Money has no intrinsic moral fiber. It's not good, it's not bad. It's what you do with it that makes it good or makes it bad. The love of money is a corrupting thing. Money itself is not. So you can't have two masters, Jesus says. So when we kind of do a flyover, we recognize the parable is talking about securing a future. The steward's story is told. And the master commends him for his efforts to secure a future. The point, Jesus says, the sons of the world, the lost, are more earnest, focused, and determined to secure a future, even if only in this life, than the sons of light, the saved, are in earnest, focused, and determined to secure a future for eternity. What's the application? Well, I believe the first application is we should use our funds and resources to support the work of the gospel. We should be in partnership with God. You should determine what you are going to give to God in offerings. Make it a percentage. As your wealth increases, keep that percentage or increase the percentage depending on what God is saying to you and what is happening in your life. But be in partnership with God. I don't have to tell you you can't outgive him. You all know that. But I am reminding you that Jesus says, this is a big deal. It's a big deal. A person, I'm reminded of the child went with his parents to church, and on the way home, the parents are just, they're ragging against the choir. Sorry, Mindy. They're ragging against the pastor. They don't like this, they don't like that. The pews are too hard, and on and on and on. And about halfway home, the little kid leaned forward and he says, but it wasn't a bad show for a dollar. See, I don't know where you're at. Only you know. And it's a question. It's an important question Jesus brings to us, and that is, what is the future we are securing? Are your thoughts towards, okay, I need X amount of money to retire, and that's my goal? You probably get there. But that's a very short-sighted goal. There's an eternity that will follow. So we should be using our funds to support the work of the gospel. We should be faithful with what God has given to us. It doesn't work. How many of you have ever heard someone say, you know, if I won the lottery, I'd pay the mortgage off on the church, right? You hear? No, you won't. You will not do that. If you're not faithful in what you have now, having more will only corrupt you more. So if you win a lot of money, let me know about it and I'll help you. Be delighted. So we must be faithful with what God has given to us, whether it's much or whether it's little. It tells what securing future, or what future we are securing, excuse me. And then Jesus says, you cannot serve God and money. You can't do both. You've heard so many sermons on that. I don't even need to say anything other than you know it. So it begs this question. What is the future you are seeking to secure? If the Lord sat down with you, looked at your life, looked at time, looked at resources, looked at the checkbook, looked at all those things, would he say, you know, I know what you're securing a future for? Would he say, I'm so sorry, you're short-sighted? Or would he say, man, you can't believe what I've prepared for you? And I'm wondering if there are any here who would like to say, Father in heaven, help me to be more eternal focused in my future thoughts. In what I think about the future, help me to be thinking in a godly way. If you want to say that to the Lord, I invite you to stand. Father in heaven, we can't do any of this without you in our heart. But we're standing because we want you in our heart. We want you to change us. We want you to make us the people you want us to be. And we know that the use of money will demonstrate a lot of that. The use of time, the use of our resources, our talents, whatever. So, Lord, please, give us a heart that will give to you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I invite you to be seated. The choir has a song they're going to sing. Sometimes there's confusion. I'm going to ask you not to sing along. They'll do that. And then we'll have our closing prayer, and you can leave.
Thank you.
We believe that Jesus will soon return. May we all be found ready to meet him in peace when he appears. Father in heaven, I pray for these dear, dear people. I ask that you will continue watching over them and their families. I pray that your presence would be so real to them that their faith in you would be strong. I'm asking that you would hear their prayers and answer those prayers according to your will. We are all praying that you will save our children, our family members, our loved ones, and our friends. We thank you, and we pray to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I hope you have a wonderful day. Hope you have a wonderful week. Go in peace, and those of you who have children in the Connection Corner, please get them. Thank you. Thank you.